I mean, the wordplay and the literary art here, he keeps doing this. Not only what he's saying is so captivating because it's a full storyline, but it is substance, it's relatable, it's heavy to listen to, almost like this movie you're watching where you're at the edge of your seat. What's gonna happen next? He's rewinding. He's rewinding with his guitar. Like, you know what I mean? Hey everybody, welcome back. Welcome to the Ultimate World Music Reaction Channel. I'm so glad you stopped by. I hope you're enjoying as I'm adding to the studio. We are all about world music, going on epic musical rides around the globe, exploring various artists, languages, instruments, cultures, and psychology, diving into the lyrics and how the music impacts us. I'm so glad you're here. I want to dive into some more Ren today. I discovered this artist thanks to you, and I checked out his song, Hi Ren. Was blown away. Then I looked at Sick Boy. Then I listened to his work with Chinchilla. Well, one of his songs with Chinchilla. More to come. And today I want to dive into something big. And that is the Trilogy. You guys have asked me to check it out. And I was told to make sure that I listen to the full thing. Meaning the whole thing. The full Trilogy. So that's what I'm going to do. I'm excited. I'm almost nervous because for one, I know you guys are going to have expectations now that you've seen me review some of his work. So I want to deliver. I want to be worthy of what I say this channel is about, which is music and psychology. But at the same time, I'm a human being. So, you know, there's also a level of subjectivity. The observer influences the observation. We'll see. But be patient with me. I hope I don't miss too much. I'm going to do my best just to share with you what I think, what I feel. Chances are you've already seen and listened to his work or this song, and now you're like just checking out reactions. But if not, and this is the first time you're experiencing this, I am excited you get to enjoy this with me. I have no idea what to expect. What I've seen so far, real quick, about Ren being this UK artist is just that he is encouraging, not only because he's very personal, he's very real and relatable. He doesn't shy away from talking about the real stuff. He addresses mental health, physical well-being, talks about his journey with his misdiagnosis. There's a lot to say about his work, his skill musically, from his guitar playing skill to his voice, the vibrato in his voice, his rapping skills. We won't go into all of that. Very talented artist. And this is me exploring more of his work, your suggestions and requests, but also I've been told this is a big one I want to check out. And I really, really hope I've picked the right one. I'm picking the one that says full in a parentheses because you asked me to check it out. The Tale of Jenny and Screech. All right, here we go. I'm excited. I'm nervous. I'm excited. Subscribe, like, comment, share. Where are you watching from? What brought you here? What do you think about Ren and this tale? All right, here we go. Okay, wait a minute. Let me go back. I'll start over. That is already really catchy. That makes me think of something. I can't place it right now. Let's keep going. Graffiti, brick walls. I really love the vibe that he keeps bringing to his videos. It adds to that brand, which is really smart. Just a certain feel it creates. Let's start over. Get out of here. Let's just... keeps happening. It keeps happening. There's something. First, I'm like, wow, his rap skills and the content of his lyrics. Then I'm checking out his song with Chinchilla and I'm like, oh my goodness, his singing voice, the vibrato, great playing guitar playing skills. His finger picking skills here. Oh my goodness, almost has a Spanish guitar vibe. And now homeboy is making like trumpet sounds with his mouth. That's not the technical official term for that, but, and it has a super jazzy 1920s vibe to it. My goodness, Hakuna Matata. And then just these little elements like the graffiti, the word meme on the right. Artist, I'm telling you. Me losing my mind over here. Ew. Artist, dude, I'm gonna start over. I promise. I'm gonna start over like 15 times. Be like, I gotta hear it again. All right, I promise this is the last time I'm starting all the way from the start.
It was a quiet, dark night in an empty street somewhere in the city. Jenny walked alone, she was dragging her feet. She was heading back home to sleep. Well, she knew this town, she knew this floor, because she walked it about 1,000 times before. She wanted to escape. Can you blame? Well, on the very same night, in a different place, there walked this hooded young youth by the name of James. He was 14 years old and out of his brain. He'd been smoking ganja with the boys. James, he grew up to be a kid of the street. His mates called him Screech, he was quick on his feet. He was a liar, a thief, at 14 years old. The devil had set his sights on his soul. As Jenny walked home all alone, she felt scared. Usually she was alright, but it was like there was something in the air. A divine intervention telling her to beware. Maybe intuition bugging her and making her so scared. Sirens sounded in the distance at the beat of Jenny's feet. A symphony of the night that echoes crime on London streets. Jenny turned. Corner, their eyes they meet. A poor girl Jenny, a boy named Screech. Give me all your money, bitch, give it to me. If you cooperate, then you'll soon be free. I want your purse, your phone, don't fucking look at me. I mean it, bitch, are you listening to me? Jenny freezes statue like a lady shakes stalactite. Feel like liquid nitrogen in the dark night. She tried to find strength to move, but stayed as still as a statue in high-heeled shoes. What the hell you playing at? You playing games with me? I swear to fucking God, I'll slice the rosy off your cheeks. You think I don't mean it, girl? You don't know me? The last thing you see will be a boy called Screech. Reach with the sheath of the blade with the teeth.
Sorry to pause. Screech reached for the wordplay and the literary art here. He keeps doing this. Not only what he's saying is so captivating because it's a full storyline. Not only is it a story, but it is substance. It's relatable. It's heavy to listen to. Almost like this movie you're watching where you're at the edge of your seat. What's going to happen next? Oh gosh, worrying and fearing the worst. But then he's singing, rapping, the vibrato in his voice. And now he's playing with these words, Screech and cheeks, and just the literary skill of songwriting, even some of his posts on YouTube. I know you fans have seen that. His community posts and stories of memories of his childhood. This kid has a talent to write. Let me keep going.
That could bite through steel and slice concrete. And he swung possessed with the devil in his chest. And the statue she was turned to butter in her breath. It was a quiet, dark night in an empty street somewhere at London City. Jenny lay still on the cold concrete. She's found somewhere to sleep. Well, she knew this town, she knew this floor, cause she'd walked it about 1,000 times before. I guess that she escaped. It's such a shame.
Wait a minute. Okay, that was Jenny. Jenny's tale. The tale of Jenny. This idea of a young lady going home, wearing high heels. She knows the town. And now this boy, James, if I heard correctly, but they called him Screech, confronting her, robbing her. Maybe worse. I'm not sure. And now suddenly switches to her laying on the floor, finding a place to sleep. My mind went to, was she raped and now her life is completely just derailed? That jazzy, timeless vibrato he is integrating in his voice as he sings is phenomenal. I love the way he's playing the guitar, how it switched from that simple, interesting hook to that Spanish guitar vibe to almost a rhythm that almost had a, Polish, Ukrainian, Russian vibe to it. To me, this is subjective interpretation. to now almost going a touch, you know, reggae and like, you know, like just street vibe, really cool. Okay, I'm gonna keep going. Now it's the tale of Screech. Okay, real quick, I'll go back to the beginning of Screech. The beginning of Screech to me almost had more of a possibly playful vibe in the beginning. Very playful. Dun, 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 and then went really fast, right? Building some type of climax, some type of crescendo. Then sad though and scary as the song progressed. Here, it almost feels a little more somber, sad, maybe a touch of confusion, or maybe this is me projecting my confusion and still trying to grasp this work. Into the black night just like snow being white. The wordplay, not just from a linguistic standpoint, but even from the content, the meaning of words, black and white, right? The dark and the night, the snow and I want to start over. Y'all are gonna be mad. I hope not, but I want to grasp it. So I think I was wrong at first. My thought about Jenny, you know, having been assaulted and now her life's derailed and she's on the street trying to find a place to sleep. It looks like she died, according to the Screech tale now. Like she's laying on the ground. I was just confused when he said she was trying to find a place to sleep. But it looks like he took her life, right? He wanted her purse and all her belongings and he killed her now. Oh my gosh. Even the way that... How can you play all these different unique riffs? Beautiful, some minor, some major chords, creating, this is why we're all about music and psychology. Even the way that the music makes us feel, from more upbeat and playful to more somber and mysterious and question mark to now just going off. I mean, his finger picking skills are phenomenal, but the emotion, the emotion that it evokes, it's like, it sucks you in. Let's start over with Screech's tale. I want to grasp that some more.
Clocked out like Big Ben. This Screech, dear boy, where did he go? He melted into the black night just like snow. Patrick, man, let me in, please open the door. I think I fucked up Patrick, really fucked up, man, I'm not sure. I got crazy, left this lady lying still on the floor. I think I killed her, Patrick, come on, man, I can't knock no more. But Screech kept on knocking till his knuckles became sore. But there's no sign of Patrick down at number 54. No refuge for our villain, for the bitter hands of fate, with something far more sinister in mind that does away. Hey, babe, are you in? Nah, nothing really, I'm just a bit tired. Listen, can I swing around yours for a few moments? I just really miss you, babe. What the fuck do you mean you're busy? You fucking bitch, for fuck's sakes! Siren sounds approaching like a banshee in the night. The shrill cry of justice cutting like the sharpest knife. But Screech was never one to run, not one to miss a fight. One hand upon his blade, he turned to face the blue lights. Come on then, you fucking cunts, let's fucking have you then. I am Screech, I'm the boss, I'm the ender of men. You think that uniform you're wearing means that you own these streets? These are my fucking streets, and they call me fucking Screech. Richard was an officer who stood at 6'3". Working London on the night shift, what he didn't think he'd see was a boy running at him like an animal possessed. With no time to hesitate, he fired 4 bullets at Screech's chest. Ah, story it ends right at the start. Young Screech and poor Jenny lying one street apart. An officer shaken by the boy that he claimed. 2 bodies lay lifeless, and it's such a shame. It's such a shame.
Okay, now run. Well done with the video, how they're shooting this. Before we watch the final one, Violet, I think this may be the longest one, and this is the 3rd. What I'm seeing so far, in addition to it being an amazingly written, performed song, is very relatable, real people stories. I'm a young woman walking home, a night like every other, maybe hanging out with her friends, having a good time. She knows the streets, this is where she possibly grew up, it's what she knows, it's familiar. A lot of times tragedy, unfortunately, seems to strike, hence why it's called a tragedy, because it's so devastating and it's unexpected, right? It's this weird dance in life between not living in fear of the other shoe to fall, not living in fear that any of us could go at any time or one of our loved ones. When you look at the news and social media, it would be easy to think the world is doomed and it's your turn next. It's scary. One extreme is to live with that constant fear that cripples you, paralyzes you from being able to live. But at the same time, there's something sombering about being aware that the things that happen that we do hear about on the news and read about are things that are really happening to people, that these tragedies that strike unexpectedly are actually occurring. And so, of course, the solution is now not to just live at the edge of our seat every day. That's not healthy. Psychologically, that release of constant stress is detrimental, physically, spiritually, emotionally, mentally speaking. But at the same time, there's something sombering about being aware that this does happen to people. And in addition to that, to see these individual people as exactly that, individuals. This Jenny going home, who comes face to face with this Screech, her fear, the things that are going on in her mind as he attacks her, as she's left behind, left to die. The things that go through her mind, the people that are going to grieve when they find her, her story that ends, you know, where she came from, what she's doing. It's individual. But the same goes for Screech. While he's portrayed here as a villain, 14 years old, that's nothing. And it's devastating to see that there's such young kids out there at that age who are making bad choices. And it would be evil to, and I'm not saying we don't call what's wrong wrong. There is a place and a time to say this is evil and this is good. And it's not about making excuses for everybody. But when you watch some of these shows like I'm a Killer, or you look into the story of a lot of people that end up being villains, you can see so much brokenness and pain even in their childhood and upbringing. Where a lot of these people that end up being murderers and that end up doing horrendous things, when you look into what they've been through, again, not to make excuses, but it changes things a little bit. It lets you see other people through the eyes of humanity to go, wow, there's a reason you ended up here. Still doesn't make it right. There still need to be consequences. There are consequences to our choices. There are wages to what we do and the people we surround ourselves with. That's why I keep saying you got to choose life every day, death or life, in what we say, what we watch, how we act, how we talk. Now I'm going to start sounding like Ren. Well, nah, I wish. But you know what I mean? Like, we have a choice and it's so important we choose life. But while our actions have consequences and we have a responsibility to encourage others to do right and to do right ourselves, the other side is that we shouldn't be so quick to go, oh, this person's evil and this one's good, and as if we have it all figured out. We don't know where some people come from and what they've been through and what we would do if we were in the same situation. Many of us are incapable of unspeakable things if we were to grow up or be surrounded with certain situations. Shows like The Walking Dead, though fictional, showcase very well, in my opinion, how societies are formed, groups and cliques that do crazy things in order to survive, where that animalistic drive in humans, that instinctual survival of the fittest mindset, comes out in the face of tragedy. Now, great things can come out too. A lot of good comes out of people when they're face to face with death and suffering. Many people rise to the occasions and surprise themselves with how amazing they are. But the same goes in both ways. There are also those who start doing unthinkable things that they never thought they would have done. So both of these, both Jenny and Screech, very tragic, different ways to start, more playful versus more somber, in my opinion, then transitioning to crazy finger-picking skills, the vibrato, like I said, that 1920s, 1930s trumpeting vibe, the graffiti, those stone walls, the colors in the background. His jacket is cool, by the way. His sweater, pullover, what he's wearing, that jumpsuit, I would love that. I would rock something like that. But yeah, it's just very cool dynamics here. The reference to Big Ben, right? There's these references that are culturally fitting to Ren's heritage, where he comes from, relatable to many of you. But then just the lyrical art here is very impressive. All right, let me stop talking. Jenny and Screech. Now it's time for Violet. I'm gonna rewind. I want to hear that again. Feels more upbeat. Feels more hopeful. Now we're in a hospital setting. Let me go back. Thank you.
city, far from pretty. 2005, a lady down in Paddington is fighting just to stay alive. Rhythmic beeps and bloodstains, she saw a lady weep, she's tired and frail. To set the scene, we must rewind the hands of time for Violet's tale.
He's rewinding with his guitar. Like, you know what I mean? How do you come up with all these different compositions? The notes so beautifully married together, creating feelings of fear, creating feelings of suspense, creating feelings of joy, almost more upbeat and hopeful for a minute, only to then transition back into more... I don't know what type of guitar this would be. It's more like a squid. Rewinding. I want to rewind. I want to hear that again. Now we're with Violet. Oh, this is getting good. Things are coming together.
Of time for Violet's tale. Was a silent girl, grew up with violent starts. Her mother was a drinker and her father was a bastard. Every night he took her tie but never left the room. I'll spare you of the things he did, I'm sure her mother knew. Violet was a silent girl, she moved out at 16. A semi-detached council flat, paid for by a welfare scheme. Packing shelves at Tesco, stacking jars like pickled bricks. She met a boy named Stevie and he was a little prick. Violet was a silent girl and Violet she fell fast. See, Stevie was a wrong un, but he sure knew how to charm her. Every night he took her tie but never left the room. History repeats itself, he'd paint her black and blue and dark. She never stood a chance. The devil comes to dance.
Violet, why are you always so quiet? On her bedroom door and he's irate. He's been drinking and smoking, he's up late. And he stands by her bedside, she shakes, but her eyes stay shut. You fucking slut, I know you're up. And he pinches her eyelids and folds them up. Violet, why are you lying to me, Violet? She stays silent, things turn violent. That's the sound of his fists when they fall like a crashing pilot. Hit like hailstones, one to the collarbone, full force, full blown, blood's black, bone crack, knick-knack, paddywhack, one to the jaw and the tooth spat, detached, fist connects and disconnects a bone. A quick deflect to misdirect the blow, but nonetheless his punches met her throat. Such a mess he's left her bruised and broke. Violet, why are you always so silent, Violet? Why are you such a little liar, Violet? Do you think I want to do this, Violet? In character, she stays silent. Well, say something, Violet! Silence. Fucking say something, Violet! Silence. Wait. Say something, Violet. Not one word. She stays quiet.
Stop, guys, okay? We're gonna keep going and then we'll talk. I got a few thoughts, but this is too deep to...
London City, far from pretty, 2005. A lady down in Paddington is fighting just to stay alive. The doctor, in a state of shock, saw something here so very wrong. See, Violet, she was pregnant. Poor Violet,
She was 9 months gone. Turning to the doctor, Violet broke her silence and she cried, if I'm to die right here tonight, please let my baby stay alive. The doctor soon regained composure, called the surgeon to come in. As Violet's world turned to black, the curtains closed, the lights went dim. In London City, far from pretty, 2005, a lady down in Paddington just lost the fight to stay alive. A tragedy or a miracle, it happened on these very streets. Two twins aligned side by side.
No.
A girl named Jenny and a boy named Screech.
No. I know now what y'all meant when you said it was heartbreaking. When it first started, I thought, oh, this is sad. You know, Jenny dying and then Screech, but it's nothing new, right? Our choices have consequences. You get in with the wrong people. You get into crime. It's sad. It's tragic, but it's life. You know, sometimes become a little desensitized to tragedy. So, you know, nothing heavy yet. And when some of you said we're speaking of the poetry and art of his writing, I thought at first maybe it's a love story, Romeo Juliet of sorts, and this has taken a completely different toll. Oh my gosh. So if I understood correctly, the story of Jenny and Screech that it started with, which also so genius to write a story with music in such a way and with guitar skills and with lyrics that it begins with the end, if you will, and comes full circle. Almost like time is an illusion, right? I know that sounds like, what? We were talking about tragedy and death, and now she's saying time is an illusion. Like, wow, she really likes to go deep. Like, now she's all over the place. Sometimes I do that, so let me try to bring it back in. What I mean by that is the idea of past, present, and future, and the idea of time is an illusion, ultimately, because even if we were to time travel, and, you know, it would be more of an alternate reality that gets created, you are always just moving towards the future. Even if you could go back, you would still be back to being present. We're always kind of just present in what we are now, even if we could time travel. To be able to write a song so artistically to take us through this journey that is a timeline, if you will, but doing it in a way that it starts with the present, but moves forward into the past. Meaning Jenny and Screech actually looks like we're the twins, the children of Violet. Violet, being a girl who was abused, molested by her father, ends up with a guy who does the same, who beats her so bad that she almost dies at the time and then eventually dies. And it turns out she's pregnant and it turns out they are twins. And those two twins end up being Jenny and Screech. Perhaps they were put into the system and now they didn't even grow up knowing their siblings. And as crazy as it would be, Screech runs into Jenny as she's going home and he kills her and then gets killed by, he was out and about, she knew the streets, a quiet night on an empty street. She was heading back home to sleep. She wanted to escape. Can you blame? I wonder if she somehow ended up in a, because perhaps she was in a system now that she had lost her mother, most likely wasn't given to her dad after he killed the mother. So maybe, who knows if her story also ended up being in a place of brokenness, maybe working the streets in prostitution or other patterns that I feel like could imply that she was also struggling with hurt and perhaps a broken life, trying to escape. Screech was a kid of the street. 14 years old, out of his brain, he'd been smoking with the boys. His mates called him Screech. He was quick on his feet, a liar, a thief. And even the literary art he was applying, that Ren was applying as it spoke about her being silent and the fist coming down like a crashing plane. I mean, the literary art he uses, be it be it metaphors, be it analogies, be it hyperboles, be it assimilations, various forms of English literary art he applies as he's writing, doing it in such a poetic way, adding rhyming. It's really profound, all while having that beautiful vibrato in his voice, going from speaking to rapping to singing, adding different sounds to the texture of his voice, to then play the guitar like nobody's business. Phenomenal art, and the storytelling here is off the charts. What it touches me to see, you guys know we like to talk about the lyrics and psychology and takeaway. I think what is brutal here is to see how it's all connected. That's my first thought. And though this could feel like a story, right? Like a movie, like unrealistic. Those things are happening. As I mentioned earlier, real people dying, hurting one another, choosing death. And what I mean by choosing death is in our words or actions, when we get involved with crime, when we get involved with the wrong people, when we continue in certain areas. But a lot of times, what's also so tragic about it is that history repeats itself, and you see these cycles from generation to generation repeat. And so while this is very much, it feels very like, this can't be real, right? How could it have all been connected? Jenny, Screech, Violet, how could it have all been connected? Those things are happening. Those things are connected, where the actions of one person affect somebody else and their life has now an impact on somebody else. One of the ways we can deal with our existential crises in life, our search for meaning, is by making wholesome memories. There's these different extremes where some people try to defy their death anxieties. I said this in my video to Hiren. Some people try to deny it. Some people search for comfort in faith. And some of those things are not bad in and of themselves. There's nothing wrong with doing fun stuff and getting an adrenaline kick. But if people are now just constantly searching for a new fix because they're so terrified of their existence being meaningless. Sorry, I'm stuck in a cable salad. If they're so terrified of their existence being meaningless that now they're constantly searching for an adrenaline fix, that's the other extreme. There's nothing wrong with faith and finding hope in an afterlife, in heaven, and more out there, something greater than ourselves. There's nothing wrong with that, in my opinion. But if we now just focus so much on heaven and the afterlife that we're not even present to the life here, I feel like that's the other extreme. And as we are trying to find meaning in that balance, meaning for our lives, one very good remedy is by creating wholesome, good memory. Another way we can deal with our existential fears and searching for meaning in this life is by connecting with other people, by projecting ourselves into the future, leaving a legacy, doing something of meaning. It doesn't have to be grand. If you're putting yourself into your work, whatever it is you're doing, you're special, so you're making it special by your existence. And when we do that, we're leaving ripple effects. Our life has an impact. Now, people may never know us by name, but what we do, how we speak, how we carry ourselves, how we choose life on our day-to-day basis is our way of leaving a ripple effect. You could affect someone without even knowing, in the grocery store, at home, at your workplace, in your school, in your classroom, with your children, with your spouse, wherever you go. And they, in turn, can affect other people, and they, in turn, can impact others. And it's this ripple effect, like when you throw a rock or a pebble in the water and you see the water ripples. And there's something very beautiful about that, how at the end of the day we realize we're all connected, even if we don't realize it. There's things that have shaped you, people that have shaped you that you may not even know, whose name you may not even know, but something they did affected someone that is in your life now. And I think something we can take from here is the reminder, it is all connected. Though this may feel like a story that is unrealistic, what is the probability of it all being so connected, right? The mother, the children, the twins. It is. That's how the world is. Even if not this obvious at times, we are all connected. The things we do, the choices we make, and every one of us has the power to choose life every day, day or life. Now, that doesn't mean that when we choose life, we're not going to be rich and happy. That doesn't mean you have someone who grows up in the foster care. If they just choose life, now they have a perfect life. You can't just say that easily to someone who's suffering and hurting, going through abuse, going through horrendous things as described here so masterfully in this trilogy. Of course, it's easier said than done. And the solution is not just to tell people, just do the right thing. When you have people addicted, it's not just something to stop. when you have people who are in that cycle of abuse or of prostitution or drug abuse or crime. It's not as easy as just get out, okay? So I don't mean it lightly when I say we all have the power to choose life. But we all do, and it takes a lot of courage, and it takes other people sometimes to say, I need help. I need to get out of this world that I'm in. It takes courage, it takes strength, it takes one another, all of us coming together saying, hey, we're connected. I'm a human being, you're a human being, my energy affects you and vice versa. For all of us to be reminded, we need to choose life. Not only for ourselves, like I said, in the way we speak, act, in the way we move, and the things we watch and the things we say, how we create, but also for the sake of others. When you choose to walk in who you were created to be, when you remember how precious you are, how loved you are, it will change your demeanor and your energy. And in turn, you will change and impact those around you. And that smile you give someone, the helping hand you give, the joy you bring, the peace you bring, because you are healing in yourself. You never know what that's going to do for someone else hurting. Your smile, your kind word, the joy you show because your healing could be something that someone else needs then and there. Maybe someone who was considering ending their life now hears your word of encouragement, now sees your kindness, and it changes. And it changes the entire trajectory of their life. So my encouragement would be to you, choose life for yourself, but also for those around you, to ask for help, to come together and realize it is all connected. And it doesn't have to end like that. Our life and our neighborhoods and our homes and our communities, they don't have to end like Violet and Jenny and Screech. And I know that sounds idealistic because we live in a very broken world, but we also live in a world where there's a lot of goodness. And again, it's easier said than done. I'm not saying this, oh, let's just slap some hope on it. This ended tragic with crying. So let's just slap some hope on it real quick. It is hard work. Those of you who are recovering addicts, I'm so proud of you. You know it's hard. It's not just stop. But every day that you choose, every minute you choose not to give up, those of you who have survived suicide attempts, those of you who are hurting, who've been through divorce, who are widows or widowers, those of you who've lost a child, those of you who are struggling with anxiety and depression today, those of you who are at home right now, tempted to fall into addictions, don't. Be strong. Find community. Find someone you can be accountable to. Choose life now. And know that you're worthy of it. Know that you are worthy to not end up like Screech, who got in the wrong crowd and made the wrong decisions, or like Jenny, or even like Violet, you know, you can get out. And we realize we're not alone. If one of us could have been a friend, hypothetically speaking, to someone like Violet, people could notice, hey, Violet's hurting, something's wrong in her home. It could save her life. If we come together and say, hey, Jenny, let's get you off the streets. If we can come together and say, hey, Screech, I know that sounds idealistic, but I've got to hold on to hope. That's my way of dealing with existential fears. If there's no hope, what is there? It's a powerful, powerful force. If you listen to Hyren, you'll see what I mean. This was phenomenal. On an artistic standpoint, songwriting standpoint, language art, musical skills, phenomenal. From a psychological standpoint, heavy, 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 heavy. But my hope, my takeaway is that we are reminded how connected it all is. And that we can choose life and either have a negative effect on what happens around us or a positive one. So propel yourself into the future, leave a legacy, leave ripple effects by choosing life for yourself and for those around you so that there don't have to be as many Jenny Screeches and Violets. This was heavy, guys. This was heavy. I don't even know what else to say. What did you think? Let me know in the comments below. What did I miss? What does this song do for you? Art is subjective. It's beautiful. And I love when we can come together and share how it impacts all of us, what it makes us think of. So talk to me. Tell me in the comments. Where are you watching from? What brought you here? Well, obviously Ren in this case, I'm sure. And yeah, what is your takeaway here? What do you see? What does it mean to you? What does it tell you? What does this art tell you? Have a great rest of your day. Remember, you are loved and you matter. And I'll see you on the next ride. Ayo!